You who were dead through the trespasses and sins, in which you once lived following the course of this world, following the ruler of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work among those who are disobedient. All of us once lived among them in the passions of our flesh, following the desires of flesh and senses. And we were by nature children of wrath, like everyone else. But God, who is rich in mercy, out of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead through our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved, and raised us up with him, and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the ages to come, he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace and kindness towards us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God, not the result of works, so that no one may boast. For we are what he has made us, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand to be our way of life. I'm going to pray for Guy very quickly, and then he will take over. Father, we thank you for the message and the spirit that you have laid on Guy this week. We pray that our hearts and our minds be open to your word this morning. In your name we pray. Amen.
Morning. I need you to trust me here. Will you close your eyes? And if you can, I want you to imagine yourself in the very presence of God. Imagine that you're standing before his throne. And he squints for just a moment, and then immediately recognizes who you are. How do you see yourself in his eyes? How does who he sees you to be make you feel? How do you feel standing there before God? Open your eyes. We'll come back to that before we're done. About a month ago, Kevin and I went down to St. Leonard's Tuesday morning, joined Tim for Eucharist. I was struck, as I always am, with the opening invitation, "Dear friends in Christ, God is steadfast in love and infinite in mercy." That's great. That's wonderful. But thereafter, I start to get fussed. God, he welcomes sinners and invites them to his table. And then the confession, "Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed by what we have done and what we have left undone." Some of you, many of you, were raised on the BCP, and there the general confession, while it rolls so eloquently off the tongue, it fusses me even more. "Almighty, most merciful Father, we have erred and strayed from thy ways like lost sheep and have followed too much the desires, devices and desires of our own hearts. We have offended against thy holy ways. We've left undone those things which we ought not to have done and not done those things which we ought to have done. And there is no health in us. Thou, O Lord, have mercy upon us, miserable offenders. Now, please, don't misunderstand me. I don't in any way take exception to thinking of myself as a miserable offender as long as we're talking about my pre-conversion identity. A miserable offender before I came into relationship with Jesus. I was certainly miserable. And there was a lot about my life. Most of my life, okay, all of my life that was offensive to God and just about anybody who knew me. But all of that fundamentally changed when I came to Jesus. The old passed away, and something new was and still is yet being formed within me. That's the gospel. That's the good news. So let's just back up a wee bit. We all continue to struggle with sin. A couple of you are nodding. Okay, that's good. Those of us who recognize that, we need to make regular, ongoing confession. Please hear me say that. I certainly do that which I ought not to do. And I leave undone those things which I ought to do. And I need to confess my failings and to ask for forgiveness on a regular basis. But in Christ, my primary identity is not that I am a failing sinner. That's not how I come to the table as a failing sinner. In Christ, we are more than even forgiven sinners. Back to our opening exercise. In Christ, your Heavenly Father sees you as his beloved son. He sees you as his beloved daughter. That's how he sees me, as his beloved son. And I know that I've been drawn into the heart of God and the steadfastness of Christ. And if we see things the way God sees them, we are to understand ourselves to be his beloved. We're to live our lives then reciprocating that love, to love our Heavenly Father back. All of that to say we are so much more than miserable offenders in Christ. Let me work this a little bit further. Nowhere in the Eucharistic liturgies of the BCP or the BAS is there any reference to Luke 22:15. That's the account of the Lord, the Last Supper. It's the start of the Last Supper. So if you will, it's the Lord's invitation to the table, his invitation. And Jesus says to his disciples, how I have longed to eat this Passover with you. In Eugene Peterson's message, it's paraphrased this way. You have no idea how much I've looked forward to eating this Passover with you. The old King James puts it literally. Because in the original Greek, there's a word there that's used twice. It's doubled. King James translates it. Jesus says, with desire, I have desired to eat this Passover with you. But we need to put that desire in its context. All 12 disciples were present. Without naming Judas, Jesus had just told them that one of them would betray him. And immediately after the supper, Jesus tells Peter that he will deny him. So at least two of the 12 who've been closest to Jesus, who knew him best, who knew his heart better than the others, two of them were about to fail him catastrophically. And yet Jesus says, "How I have longed to eat this Passover with you." Judas and Peter are about to do that which they ought not to have done. And yet Jesus doesn't mention anything at all about them being miserable offenders. Jump 2,000 years. Jesus still wants to share bread and wine, share his very life with us. With desire, he still desires to share bread, wine, his very life with us. And so the question that well and truly cracks the universe, at least it cracked my little universe, does Jesus see me first and foremost as a sinner who needs to make confession? Or does he see me as one beloved, one with whom he eagerly desires to share his life and his love with? Let me put it slightly differently and ask you, do you understand yourself as a sinner who struggles to love God? Or do you know yourself to be the beloved of God who struggles with sin? This morning's sermon title is The Grammar of the Gospel. We're just dealing a bit of the grammar of the gospel. From our text that James read, Ephesians 2, 1 to 10, begins verse 1, once, as in once upon a time. Once you were dead because of your sins and wickedness. The verb tense here, grammar, the verb tense is past. We were dead because of our sin and wickedness. Verse 3, also past tense. We were ruled by our physical desires. But then Paul changes his grammar. Verse 4, God is, present tense, God is rich in mercy. And because of his great love for us, he brought us to life with Christ when we were dead because of our sins. It is by grace you are saved. Grammatically, he's made a mess of things because he keeps changing verb tenses, but that's exactly his point. What's past is behind us, because what is now in Christ is our present and will yet be our new future. We were dead, past tense. We are saved. It's not just present, it's perfect tense. Verse 6, and he raised us up in union with Christ and enthroned us with him in the heavenly realms. See, our opening exercise isn't just fantasy. That's where God sees us in Christ, with him in the heavenly realms. Verse 8, by grace you are saved through faith. It's not your own doing. It's God's gift. Now, I know that grammar doesn't do it for a lot of you. There's some of us that get a kick out of it. It's juiced. So let me suggest this by way of an illustration. Robert Capon suggested it in his book, The Mystery of Christ and Why We Don't Get It. I want to work it way harder than he does. Pretend that a guy named Wilbur is in hospital. We don't have a Wilbur here, do we? I don't want to offend anybody. No Wilbers? If not, we'll switch it to Buford. I know there aren't any Bufords here. No Wilbers? Okay, we'll stick with Wilbur. Pretend that Wilbur got really, really drunk, and like a complete idiot, he got in his car, but he was so inebriated, he crashed it, totaled the car. It was only the airbags that saved his life. But he is pretty busted up. So many different injuries. And Wilbur is also broke. Let's pretend he's not an Ontario resident, so OHIP will not be covering his medical bills, but he's got no way to pay for them. Absolutely no way. Not only that, but Wilbur's house is a dump. The front porch is falling off its foundations. The siding doesn't need just painting. Some of it's rotten, some of it's fallen off. The plumbing doesn't work most of the time. The roof leaks. He hasn't paid his electricity bill for months. That got shut off a long time ago. He hadn't paid the property tax or the mortgage. The bank is foreclosing. Wilbur's situation is dire. He is miserable. And his life is offensive to anyone who comes close. Now, let's pretend that I visit him in hospital. And let's pretend that I tell Wilbur that I am his benefactor. Think of me as one of Oprah's angels. I assure him that he has absolutely nothing to worry about. Absolutely nothing. And I smile. And Wilbur wonders if I'm out of my mind. But then I tell him that I've paid his medical bills. I've set up a trust fund to cover whatever will yet be outstanding. Not only that, while he's been lying in hospital bed all busted up, I've hired a rental crew to do his house up. They've jacked up the front porch, rebuilt it. They've sorted the siding and the plumbing and the roof, painted the whole thing inside out. I paid what was owing on his electricity bill. Also paid the back taxes and the mortgage. Got them covered going forward. And I assure Wilbur that his desperate life, as he knew it, it's all behind him. The only thing is there's a catch. There's always a catch. There's something he has to do. Wilbur has to believe that I've done all of this for him. If he doesn't, he'll still be tormented by worry about his medical bills, about the fact that the bank is going to foreclose on the dump of his house. He has to believe, present tense, in what I've done on his behalf, past tense. If he chooses to believe all that I've done for him, he can relax and start enjoying my incredible kindness. He can start living a whole new life. That's the gospel. We were dead because of our sins and wickedness, but God is rich in mercy. And because of his great love for us, he brought us to life with Christ when we were dead because of our sins. It is by grace we are saved. Not our own doing. It's God's gift. What all of this means is that no matter how badly we fail on a particular day or a particular week, or if you're open door, in a particular month, when we come to the table, there's nothing we can do or can have done to make God see us in Christ as anything but righteous, not miserable offenders, but His beloved. Because how God sees me has nothing to do with my behavior, good or bad. Now, I know that that does some of your heads in. It should, because that's the scandal of the gospel. It's what Jesus has done for us. It's not about us. Let me put things on pause for just a moment and briefly address what is always the inevitable question. If how God sees us has nothing to do with our behavior, good or bad, then we have carte blanche. We can live quite literally however we damn well please. It's absolutely correct. It's idiot thinking, but it's absolutely correct. Let me use the illustration again. My wife, Carrie, loves me. Loves me in wonderful ways. And in that wonderful love, I have carte blanche. I can respond to her wonderful love in any way I please. What do I want to do? What do I want to do with her love? I want to love her back. And her love, it makes me want to be a better man. So with God's love, we can do with it whatever we want. Makes me want to be a better man. What we've been talking about this morning is primary identity. That's why we started with the imagination exercise at the very beginning. Seeing ourselves before God. Our primary identity determines how we see ourselves. If you had trouble seeing yourself before God, I appreciate for some of you, how do you see yourself standing in front of the bathroom mirror at 2:53 in the morning? What do you see when you stand there looking eyeball to eyeball? That's primary identity. No clothes on, just unvarnished. Who's staring back? Certainly our roles play a part in determining our identity. I'm a husband, and a father, and a preacher, and an aspiring golfer. Our background, our history plays a part in our primary identity. I was raised by Brits, but in Canada. I'm white, I'm male, I'm university educated. All of that plays a part. But none of that plays into my primary identity. In fact, if somebody bases their primary identity solely on race or gender or economic status, they have a very small self, very limited self. Here's what I hope you take away from this message. In terms of identity, energy flows where attention goes. Energy flows where attention goes. Let's take a bit of a worst case scenario. If a person has been horribly victimized and they continuously focus on that trauma, that's where their attention goes. They're spending their personhood energy on the trauma, and they take on a victim identity. If all of their attention is on the trauma, it just starts to suck the life out of them. Because in this case, fear is a negative energy. Anger is a negative energy. Bitterness is an energy. And fear and anger and bitterness, that toxic swirl of a cocktail, it poisons life. Energy flows where attention goes. But in that exact same circumstance, the exact same circumstance of horrible victimization, it's possible for a person to focus on redemption, to focus on restoration, to focus on a future and a hope. If that's where their attention is, they'll spend their energy on forgiveness. And that flow of energy creates for them the identity of a victorious overcomer. The energy of peace and freedom and hope, they carry the day. And it's one of the consequences of worship. As we focus on the goodness, the mercy, the unfailing love of God, of our Heavenly Father, something shifts inside us. Because energy flows where attention goes. The peace of God begins to guard our hearts and our minds again. Hope starts to rise up from within again. And there's a buoyancy that sustains us. So I'm going to ask you to close your eyes again. And hear how the Apostle Paul opens his letter to the Ephesians. We read from Ephesians 2. This is from Ephesians 1. Hear this deep in your heart. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has conferred on us in Christ every spiritual blessing in the heavenly realms. Before the foundation of the world, he chose us in Christ to be his people, to be without blemish in his sight, to be full of love. And he predestined us to be adopted as his children through Christ Jesus. In Christ, you are the Lord's beloved, and all grace abounds to you. May you know that in your heart of hearts. The Lord bless you. Amen.